The pre-clearance process for insider trading. Oh my. Unless you've been in-house, you don't realize what a hassle this can be. You're the no guy or gal. That doesn't win you any friends. But you're the adult in the room. It's critical to keep your officers, directors, employees from running afoul of the insider trading laws. And a sound pre-clearance process is a mainstay in showing that your company has a solid compliance culture. That's important to stave off liability for the company and to maintain your own job. Today on Zippy Point. I'm Brock Romanek, and I'm a big fan of yous. Pre-clearance of trades is one of those bread and butter topics if you're an in-house securities lawyer. It involves a number of practices that are at the heart of the soft stuff. Having good judgment really counts here. So who's subject to pre-clearance? All the directors on the board and your Section 16 officers. This helps you with complying with Section 16's reporting requirements and monitoring any potential short swing problems under Section 16B. And I have a separate vid guide about how do you determine who your Section 16 officers are. And then pre-clearance also helps you to draft your proxy and monitor compliance with your stock ownership guidelines. Then there are those employees that require pre-clearance because they're regularly come into possession with material non-public information. So those are your employees in the accounting, finance, legal departments. And then finally, there's those employees working on a secret project. I love saying secret project. I often joke with people that I'm putting them in charge of this of secret projects, you know, when you're doling out responsibilities on a camping trip or something and you have someone that you don't really want to be handling anything important, you're in charge of secret projects. Anyways, those employees that are working on that secret project, working on a potential merger about, you know, about to land a major contract, things like that, for a discrete period of time, they get to join that blackout period club on a temporary basis. So here are five important judgment calls you might make when clearing trades. One, ask the right questions. Two, don't spill the beans. Three, do your own diligence. Four, document or not. Five, try not to be jaded. One, ask the right questions. So for starters, hopefully you've gotten blessing from someone above to implement the cardinal rule for those subject to pre-clearance. Don't even dream about trading in our stock until you first talk to blank, usually it's until you. And it's a simple rule, and if it's followed, it should help relieve a lot of potential headache, assuming you're doing your job properly in pre-clearing the trades once people come to you. And if you get called to pre-clear a trade, usually it's an email, consider who's asking. What department are they in? Is this someone who normally isn't asking to trade? You know, that raises a red flag. If it's someone in the controller's group, they're pretty highly attuned to trading issues. The IT department, not so much. How high up is this person? A senior manager or a mid-level or low-level employee? So pay attention to your gut instincts here. Practice that. You have instincts. We all do. Use them. We choose whether to use that intelligence in our own actions. Are any red flags going up immediately? Did your neck tighten up a little bit? Stomach start to gurgle, that old eye twitch is coming back. Really pay attention to the details the requester gives you. Take a deep breath and listen. And then prod them with the negotiation technique of light mirroring so that they give you more information. Repeat the last few words they say when there's a natural pause. So for example, if they end a sentence with, so I need to sell now to make rent. And then you respond simply with, so you need to sell to make rent? You know, in the form of a question. So that'll encourage them to keep on going, and they might drop a few nuggets that you need to make your decision about whether they're allowed to trade or not. Of course, this equation involves your own abilities, your own judgment about what you're hearing. Do the circumstances they're telling you seem like the information they know is considered material under the law? I should mention then, you also have people who get promoted and they're now a new blackout period member, and they get the standard, now you're a big shot training packet. And you know, but maybe you're going to find out that they've done some funky stuff with the employer's stock in the past. You know that they're a big shot and you're having this conversation, the training, and then they tell you that they've had a hedge, a cower going up on your stock. So check on these new members to the club to determine whether they've done some weird stuff with the company stock before they were promoted. You might get surprised. Two, don't spill the beans. So the other reason you need to ask the right questions is that you might know some material non-public information that the person that's coming to you, that they don't know. And so you should not presume that they know it too. Let them be the one that indicates what they know. Three, do your own diligence. So there's two flavors of situations that should get your little antenna to perk up. The first is if you see an insider, a high-level executive, a C-suiter, making an unusual trade. So you should dig around a little if you see an unusual trade. Maybe they're aware of some upcoming mass media article that they gave a quote in, that they've heard about, something that's about to break that's going to send the stock flying in one direction or another. Even if they're not looking to trade based on that information, the optics are not going to look good. They're going to look bad. You're going to look bad. So ask around. Ask the communications department if they know of anything, the IR department, maybe another senior officer, maybe even a director. Sniff around a little. It's worth spending that time to save yourself from a reputation-harming incident that you could have avoided. The second flavor here relates to noting what area of the company the requester works in when you get that call. It matters. So I already mentioned the IT department. That's always a common one these days because of cyber breaches. So maybe they might be aware of a cyber breach that hasn't percolated up yet to senior management. No one in senior management knows about it yet. You need to find out. Four, document or not. So whether you document all your interactions with insiders is up to you. You would do this kind of thing to protect yourself in the case someone called you on the mat as to whether you really gave them clearance or not. It's your word against theirs. And a contemporaneous note, you know, might bolster your case. Or maybe you just rely loosely on the back and forth emails you have with the requester and you don't keep a formal log. That's a lot of work to keep a formal log. That really is a lot of work to keep a formal log if you get a lot of these requests, but maybe you don't get so many. So I've talked to some people who do maintain logs of all their communications with insiders that want to trade. And even talked to a few insiders who have built a software program where it automatically documents every question that comes in quite a bit of detail. The downside to all this is that all the communications relating to the request then tend to be through email, something electronic, and you miss those golden opportunities to tease out more facts, the nuances that you might get if you're able to have an actual conversation with them, either on the phone or face-to-face, that might lead you to give the opposite advice that you otherwise might give. Five, try not to be jaded. So these real-world exercises come out of the blue. You get a call, you're in the middle of doing something, and you get a call or someone pops in your office, and all of a sudden you're being told by someone that they need to make a trade to buy a new house tomorrow, the closing's tomorrow. So if you can, try to be flexible and accommodate them. You know, don't have that knee-jerk reaction and say no. But you also don't want to rush into something and get yourself in trouble. So it's a delicate balance here. Everyone's going to have a story about why they should be allowed to trade. They're going to get mad at you. But they know the drill deep in their heart. Otherwise, they wouldn't be asking you whether they're allowed to trade. They're fishing for an answer to CYA themselves, to cover themselves. So the bottom line here is this is a challenge. You want to be fair. You don't want to be jaded because you've been through this time and time again. But then again, it's your job to say no when it's appropriate. So what you're really saying to someone is, unless they're a Section 16 officer, is it's up to you. I wouldn't make that trade, but I can't stop you. But the SEC will find you. They have sophisticated tracking software. And if there's the slightest blip, they will see it. I will be happy to visit you in jail. So I actually have a separate vid guide about insider trading and messages, the message cases that the SEC has brought over the years to try to scare people in, you know, out of making illegal insider trades. So I would have a look at that. And then I also have another vid guide about the sophisticated software that the SEC and FINRA specifically uses to track all the trading, to catch all those blips. So the link to both those videos are beneath this video. Enjoy.